What role, if any, do safe assets play in the functioning of, strictly from a micro point of view, on the financial system? Is there a scarcity of safe assets? I think that is not the point to be discussed. I think that would be the starting point of the speakers this afternoon. This scarcity of safe assets, as I say, is a starting point. It's also a fact that has been taken as given. And it's also a fact that, if I remember well, first appeared, at least in my memory, in Greenspan's time as a reason and something behind Greenspan's conundrum. With this as a starting point, we'll have a first presentation by Professor Ricardo Caballero, here to my right. Professor Caballero is the Ford International Professor of Economics at MIT. He's also director of the MIT's World Economic Laboratory, and he holds a PhD from MIT. His research fields are basically, I understand, macroeconomics, international economics, and finance. Today, we'll be making a presentation based on a set of papers that he has authored or co-authored with some of his colleagues at MIT. And the most recent one, I believe, is one which I read, went through yesterday, called Safe Assets, Scarcity, and Aggregate Demand. I guess his presentation will be based on that paper. And I quote at the paper's conclusion is that, and I quote, policies that increase the net supply of safe assets somewhere are output enhancing everywhere. We will also have two presentations by Professor Marco Pagano here on my left and by Professor Markus Brunnenmeier, also to the far left. Professor Pagano is well known. He's a professor of finance at the University of Naples, Federico II. He's also president of the Einaudi Institute for Economics and Finance, and also chair of the Advisory Scientific Committee of the SRB. He also holds a PhD in economics from MIT. We have a crop of MIT representatives here this afternoon. And he has done research, extensive research, basically, if I quote, from corporate finance, banking, and financial regulation. Also, Professor Brunnenmeier will be presenting, like Mr. Pagano, a paper on which I would comment. He is Edward Sanford Professor of Economics at Princeton University. He's director of the Benheim Center for Finance, which is a prestigious center of finance. He holds, he's the exception, a PhD from the London School of Economics, and he has research interest in international financial markets and the macroeconomy, with emphasis, I believe, on bubbles, liquidity, and financial stability issues. The two will make a presentation based on a paper that they have co-authored, titled SBs, Safety in the Tranches. If Mr. Professor Caballero concludes that creating and solving the shortage of safe assets is a good thing, the two authors, speakers on my left, they will treat the logical implication. Can we increase the supply of safe assets? That's a financial engineering problem, more so if what the starting point is unsafe assets. From a bunch of unsafe assets, we will be creating a safe asset. That, I think, is the content of the paper they will be presenting. They will be dividing their presentation on, I don't know how exactly. And finally, we will have, and this is to my fire art, right, Jeremy Zettelmeier, which will be discussing the three presentations. Dr. Zettelmeier is a senior fellow at the Peterson Institute for International Economics. He's also, I've checked, chief economist of the German Economics Ministry. Is that right?
I was.
Ah, well, you were. Okay. That's why I was checking with you. And now I understand you are director of research at European Bank for...
That's also an old
job. Oh, and then... Well, then they don't... I don't...
Just Peters.
Peterson is...
I have a PhD from MIT.
Yes. That. Okay, I was going to to mention that. You joined the club. You are entitled to join the club. Okay.
Marcus deserves an honorary degree.
We are 10 minutes behind the schedule. Well, I don't know whether the schedule included this short presentation. So my instructions to you, you will have each of the speakers will have, and including the discussant, will have, let's say, 15 to 20 minutes, an average of 18 minutes. Hopefully, we will make it at 2:30, 1 hour, yeah, so 14:43, and we will have 30 minutes for each speaker to reply to probably the questions that Jeremy Zettelmeyer will pose, and for the audience to answer some questions. So I'll give the floor to Professor Ricardo Caballero.
Thank you very much, Julio Duran. Do you want me to stand up, speak from here? What do you prefer? What is the strategy? Anyways.
It's for you to decide. I have no
I have the option?
Yeah, you can.
I can control this from there. Safer. So anyways, I'm part of the supporting cast here. Really, the beef of this session is their proposal, and I'm just supposed to give some introductory remarks on why safe assets are important in the functioning of the macroeconomy. Certainly, they have a fundamental role for the management of individual institutions, but my angle is more of a macroeconomic angle. So there's no doubt that in general, the store of value is important for many things that matter for macro, for aggregate demand, for example, and also from the supply side. So they matter for production, investment, and consumption activities. It is store of value is what allows us to decouple current income from the expenditures that are needed for different variety of activities. Now, safe stores of value play a very special role in this context, and that's particularly the case in times of great uncertainty, either perceived or actual uncertainty, but the safety aspect of that store of value plays a very important role. And as we have been discussing, and I pretend to say a bit more about, there is a large number of consequences that can emerge in an economy once there is a shortage of these problems. And the last point that I want to make that has been made already repeatedly in this conference is that this is a problem that not about the future, it's not about the past, it's about the present. The present and the past and the future, but it's very important today. There I have just a quote from Narayana Kocherlakota in his previous job, People Do Move in Different Jobs, so, in which he essentially argued that this was perhaps the most important problem that central bankers were facing at this time. Now, you ask a very good question, which is, what is a safe asset? And here I have some responses by institutional portfolio managers, and you know, it varies. And it's not surprising that it varies. I can't even read what is in there, but the point is that there are many answers. But it's not surprising because what is safe depends on the individual portfolio, or the particular point in time, what is the main concern for that investor, what is the regulation for that investor, and so on and so forth. The working definition that I have adopted together with my co-authors, by the way, one of them will be presenting one of the formal papers related to that one in the next week's conference. Here I'll just talk about sort of the general principles. But the working definition we have used there is that it's an asset that preserves much of its value in a large systemic event. And what is a systemic event that can also vary over time, at some points inflation, but nowadays it's really a big financial crisis, a big recession. And that has been for us, again, the working definition of what is a safe asset. And who demands these safe assets? Well, sovereigns, especially in emerging markets, insurance companies, pension funds, mutual funds, the financial system, who produces safe assets were very few people, really. Safe assets in the sense I just defined. Sovereigns, mostly in developed markets, not all of them. Very few corporations can do that. And the financial system, but it does require a lot of financial engineering, really, to produce truly safe assets from the financial system. How did we get into this problem of shortage of safe assets? Well, there are many, many reasons, many structural reasons that have already been mentioned. Demographic factors have played indeed a big role. There are regulatory reasons that have increased the demand for safe assets, the usage of safe assets as well. There are issues of storage of safe assets and velocity of circulation of safe assets. Both have been affected recently. But I think another factor that was not mentioned here and that has been very important over the last 15 to 20 years is the behavior of emerging markets. We used to have, especially after the Asian crisis, we saw a very unstable periphery of the world. The core looked very robust. So the solution for the periphery, one of the solutions for the periphery was to essentially to stock up on assets, safe assets from the stable core, and build massive amount of reserves. Yesterday, somebody said in response to my radical acceptance points, the radical acceptance points of small open economies is buffers, buffers, buffers. Well, the Asian economies took it very, very literally, and they built big, big buffers as a result of that crisis. And you can see actually the effect of that crisis on rates. And this is just to corroborate the point of who has been demanding and who has been supplying the assets. Obviously, big role of China, and the US is on the other side, on the supply side. Oil producing the Middle Eastern economies and China have played a big role. Not only China, but primarily China. Let me skip all that. Now, we all know that put enormous pressure on the financial system. So that was the demand side, which was a structural factor sort of building. And then sort of the core that was producing these safe assets sort of couldn't take it anymore. And in finding excuses to build new safe assets, and eventually the system blew up. To tell you the truth, this works for the periphery in the sense that the periphery look a lot more stable than it would have looked in the past in the presence of a similar shock. The core itself looked quite unstable. Now, the world didn't have the option of really swapping the periphery for the core, and then we had the situation of safe asset shortage resolved because the size of the financial markets in the periphery is sort of an order of two orders of magnitude smaller than that of the developed economies. But the point of this slide is to show that also the supply side of safe asset market sort of contracted very dramatically. Now, there are different estimates out there of which obviously vary depending on what you think is a safe asset or not. But this is one illustrative table which was put out by Berkeley a while ago and has been sort of reproduced at the IMF and other places. But the point of that table is that essentially the supply of safe assets was cut in half as a result of the subprime crisis. A big part of it came from essentially the privately or semi-privately produced safe assets in the US, and the other half came from essentially European sovereign debt that was no longer considered part of the safe asset supply. Okay, so big structural trend that hasn't gone away, and a big contraction in the supply, and some may argue, well, was a perceived supply, was never really safe, and that connects a little bit with the points that were made this morning, but and it's a very important point. But that's the way the world felt after the financial crisis in terms of these markets. And the implications are of the kind we have already discussed. No, we had this structural decline in interest rates, which was exacerbated. It was not started by the crisis, but it was exacerbated very rapidly by the crisis, not only the subprime crisis, but those that follow. There are other implications as well. No, it's in an environment like this. It's something actually I talked about in an annual conference here at the ECB in 2006. It's an environment like this, you're going to tend to see bubbles popping up. No? When there is excess savings in general, you tend to see bubbles. When there is a shortage of safe assets, you tend to see bubbles in things that can be perceived as safe for a while. My Chinese is not very good, but I think that means sort of parking spots in Hong Kong or something like that. So the price of parking spots, which you know is some real estate type thing, was very bubbly during this time. But there certainly you can see in emerging markets in general, sort of real estate markets are sort of typical sort of safe store of value that emerges in a situation like that. The other implication, you know, naturally was that the private sector had a strong incentive to produce these safe assets. The corporations have a hard time producing them, especially when the natural corporations sort of have run out of the debt they want to issue. And so then we needed a lot of creativity, and the creativity we all understand now took place in the financial system, particularly in the US, but it also involved European banks, certainly buying and holding them. That industry had a hard time. That, I think, was a very central part of the subprime crisis, and also obviously was a very central part of the contraction in the supply of safe assets. And the implications then, let me insist on the interest rate, but also on a point that was made this morning, is that certainly safe rates, which is the lower blue, the darker blue line there, area, declined structurally for quite some time, but it essentially hit zero very shortly into the subprime crisis. At the same time, however, the equity risk premium, this is a forward-looking complex equity risk premium, has not declined. It actually has increased over this period of time. So that essentially puts us into what we call a safety trap. And a safety trap is like a liquidity trap, in the sense that is the safe rates behave very much as their interest rate behaves in a standard liquidity trap. But it's a safety trap in the sense that it is produced by a scarcity on a very particular kind of asset, which is much harder to produce than general wealth. And a reflection of that, that it is the safe asset that matters and not the other kind, is again the fact that this premium has remained very hard. And there are many things that, so to think sort of, you want to think very broadly about what a safety trap is, it's a liquidity trap that is not responsive to any form of wealth increase. You know, in a standard liquidity trap model, the role of whoever is doing policies to somehow inflate wealth. One way or the other, that's what you need, that's what is gonna boost aggregate demand, and that's when it's gonna take you out of it. That doesn't really work when the reason for that is a shortage of the safe asset, because what is the binding constraint is a scarcity of a particular form of asset, and it is only an increase in that kind of asset that will relax the constraint that is producing a liquidity trap type phenomenon. So you can have situations in which an equity market is booming, but it's not pulling investment out, for example, no? Which I would say is one of the main relationships that has shifted in the post-crisis period. And when you're stuck in a safety trap, you tend to get very much the kind of things that happen when you're stuck in a liquidity trap, which is that it's hard to get out of economic malaise. It's hard to recover in an environment like that. I'm not going to present any models or anything, but just to keep to give you an illustration of a model that we all have in mind, if has taken at least a principle of economics course, is this famous Keynesian cross, knowing which you have an aggregate demand output, determined output, now you have a 45-degree line, and then there is an aggregate demand, which is a little flatter. Well, all that changes, you can write very fancy model, but all that really changes if you put one of these safety components in it, is that one key shifter of the aggregate demand is the availability of, is the supply of safe assets. So you can write literally your standard Keynesian cross model, but now you will see that in your aggregate demand, there would be a supply of safe assets that pops up in there. Therefore, if you have contraction in the supply of safe assets, is supply of safe assets or net demand of safe, net supply of safe assets, net of demand, okay? But at certain interest rate. But what happens, therefore, if there's a contraction in that supply of safe assets, is that it's equivalent to, in your standard Keynesian cross model, sort of a drop in autonomous consumption, autonomous investment, or something of that kind. So a shift downward in aggregate demand. And therefore, one solution to this problem is to increase the supply of safe assets. And there I have my Go SBs, you know, as one of the ways of doing that. Which I think is very welcome. Another implication of an environment like that is that the effects gets more or less indeterminate, actually, in that environment, for reasons that are fairly technical, but in a world in which interest rates are persistently stuck around zero, output becomes endogenous and the effects is becomes undetermined. And what happens there is that the total size of the liquidity trap in the world is more or less fixed. It's not fixed, but it's more or less fixed. And the location of that liquidity traps to different regions depends on the exchange rate. Okay, so the incentives to start using the exchange rate essentially to relocate aggregate demand are even stronger than in the natural, the standard Mandel-Fleming setup. Other implications that were also mentioned in the morning is that obviously the incentive for the private sector to produce safe assets, you know, you get great rewards of doing that. One manifestation we have seen this is in the emerging market world, sort of a big increase in corporate debt issuance. Actually, Latin America didn't have that stuff, and now you can find it even in ETFs. Okay, so big incentives to produce now that to transform emerging markets, it's the highly rated emerging market corporations, to transform them into really truly perceived safe asset probably needs an extra layer of CDOs, of SPVs, something like that. But the inputs at least are being created in the same sense as the subprime loans were being created that eventually were packaged and so on. Other reactions, yeah, well, central banks have reacted to a liquidity trap-type phenomenon by accumulating, by doing lots of things that you normally do with monetary policy and go way beyond that, massive accumulation of assets in the balance sheet of central banks, part of which I like and part of which I dislike, and that's what I want to talk about. I think that the initial reaction of the Fed was very much what you want to do in a world like this. In a world in which you have a shortage of safe assets, you want someone to take that risk that people don't want and swap them for something safe, which is what the world wants at that moment. And the initial QE policies that the Fed had were very much of that kind. Now, gradually over time, that was shifting, and the composition of safe to risky assets was changing to eventually end up with Operation Twist, which I think was highly counterproductive in my view. It was highly counterproductive in my view because, you know, if you at least you do the standard open market operations, you are essentially swapping a very safe asset for another safe asset. You're swapping short-term debt for reserves. When you start going into operation twist type things, you take a safe asset away, which is or you inject a safe asset, which is reserves or short-term treasuries, but you take away a very scarce safe asset, which is long-term safe assets, which are very important for insurance companies, for mutual funds, for pension funds, and so on. And in fact, it's a negative beta asset, and a negative beta asset with respect to systemic events I had in mind counts more than one for one in terms of a safe asset, because it allows you something else that is risky to become safe as well once you combine it with this thing that has a negative beta. So I like very much what the Fed did early on. I like a lot less what happened in the later stages. I like a lot more what Europe does, precisely because the national central banks have some discretion at least of what they target, and they're expanding the programs way beyond sort of the typical safe assets. I don't think it makes any sense. I understand their mandates for the ECB to be buying bonds, but you know, I understand their constraints and parameters and so on. And I understand the institutions are supposed to be a little bit more rigid than we are, because that's what preserves certain things, but there is a limit, and I guess that now you're finding sort of a shortage of assets in general, you may well be reaching the limits of all that. So what's next? Let me conclude here before the real show starts. I mean, one way of sort of capturing in an image, I think, what is happening, I think what is likely to continue to happen is I tend to think of the hoteling model. The hoteling model, if you remember, is this model in which is a finite, exhaustible resource, and the price keeps rising, no, because people are using it and you cannot reproduce it. Well, I feel very much that's what has been happening to safe assets when you normalize them by the rate of world growth of the demand for safe assets, which includes demographic factors, which includes the factor that China grows at a faster, which demands lots of these assets, grows at a faster rate than those assets that produce, those countries that produce the safe assets. But it's very much a hoteling-like view. And I think the early phases of the solution of that problem was fairly benign, which is to say, well, you know, you don't have enough safe assets. One thing you can do is increase the value of these assets. And a very natural mechanism to increase the value of those assets is for interest rates to decline. As interest rates decline, the value of safe assets, as safe interest rates decline, the value of safe assets sort of went up. So that was a very benign resolution of this shortage of safe assets. Eventually, we hit the zero lower bound, and that benign mechanism sort of went away. Yet you didn't have the valuation channel anymore. And now the next valuation channel in line is FX. You know, you can increase the FX, appreciate the currencies of those countries that produce these safe assets, you know, Switzerland, the US, and so on. And that in itself solves a little bit of the shortage of the assets, but it starts having much more macroeconomic consequences because it affects certain countries more than others. No? We also can affect quantities, and certainly the issuance of more public debt from those countries that can issue it, not anyone, those countries that can issue it, is a way of increasing the supply of safe assets. Now, we all know that there are political limits to those kind of things. And some of those political limits are justified, although I think there is a space in many places to expand it. I think they are justified because the argument that, and again was said a little earlier, the argument that, you know, you can issue as much debt as you want because you're not paying anything for this debt, is a typical dynamic inefficiency type argument, and that requires coordination, and coordination can go wrong. I mean, you know, in a world in which people vote Brexit or elect Donald Trump, I wouldn't trust so much in backward induction. We'll get us always to the equilibrium we want, and so on. So it's good to be a little concerned about things that are somewhat fragile. Funding infrastructure makes a lot of sense to me with the capacity we have because it improves both sides of the equation in the sense that it produces the type of debt we need, and it also has a potential to increase growth, which is something you also need. You need these core economies to grow a little faster in order to close that imbalance. Private substitutes, I think that we'll need them, but we know the fragility. We already went through a round like this. I think that one way or the other, we have to use the capacity of the private sector to generate these safe assets, but understand that they cannot really ensure the systemic tail event, the truly tail event, and for that, you need some sort of public-private cooperation. I think it makes little sense that you issue just a government debt for every single instance, but I think there are certain events for which you need them, and it makes sense, I think, to involve the private sector taking over all that part that you don't need the public debt for and just specialize on something. And of course, there are issues of moral hazard, how much you charge them, and so on and so forth. But those problems don't seem enormously large relative to the other enormously large problems we're facing. And the last point I want to make is that, well, if something is very scarce, don't waste it. No, and I think that so you can also reduce demand for safe assets. And I think when you start looking for reductions of demand for low-hanging fruits there, I think central banks look very, very apparent to all of us. In emerging markets, there is a good reason. There are effects reasons, but there is also precautionary reasons to buy these assets. But there is a lot of space for pooling. And I think that you know, swap lines and all these kind of things that the IMF has been working on, it makes a lot of sense to me in that world as a way of reducing the waste of, it doesn't make any sense that every single country has a big pile of reserves. It would make a lot of sense to do a little bit of pooling there and to also use the facilities of the developed world for instances, for a very extreme instances. And in the case of developed markets, I think that what I said before, I think they should focus on risky assets. I understand there are lots of mandates issues, institutional issues, but if there are issues to work on, are those issues, because it makes very little sense that you know, a very large share of the US treasuries are really being held by central banks. It's international central banks, the Fed itself is holding a big share of those instruments, and I think it's very wasteful.
Thank you, Professor Caballero. Very interesting. I guess Jeremy Zittelmeyer will have questions on the conceptual framework, which I believe is a Mundell type of model where you have an additional constraint. And very interesting also insights on monetary policy from the Fed and fiscal policy. The policies of central banks with regard to investment of reserves and how many reserves do we have. So I guess the audience will have many questions on that. Now, we go to Professor Pagano, who will be illustrating us on the financial engineering problem of how to construct a safe asset out of set of less safe assets.
Right. Okay, thank you for having me here. And as was already said, I'm drawing on a joint work not only with Markus, who will present the second part of this paper, but with Sam Langfield, Stein van Neuberg, Ricardo Reis, and Dimitri Vajanos. So essentially, the issues I'm going to touch upon are three. First of all, the rationale of this object, SBIS, that I will explain about in my talk. The second is how safe can we really make them, depending in particular on their so-called tranching point or subordination level, and how much safe assets can we produce this way. And the third, since I will answer the second question by producing the results of some simulations that are in our paper, which take as given the probabilities of default of euro area sovereigns, I will ask a kind of Lucas critique type of question, which is what if actually SBIS themselves were to affect to some extent these probabilities of default as well as the correlations between default? What can we expect on that front? And I will try to address that by presenting the results of a very simple model. Now, the rationale for the introduction of such a safe assets, in particular with reference to the euro area, is twofold. First of all, the so-called diabolic loop that we have been experiencing during the sovereign debt crisis in the last few years in the euro area, that is the feedback loop between sovereign and banking risk, by which a shock to sovereign solvency affects the value, mark-to-market value of bank equity, leads them to deleverage, generating a credit crunch which lowers tax revenue and therefore has repercussion on sovereign solvency, as well as generating potentially the intervention of the sovereign to bail out the banks with negative equity value, which also has a negative effect on sovereign solvency, which feeds back upon, again, banks. So now, this why the introduction of a safe asset can mitigate or even eliminate this diabolic loop? Well, to the extent that banks, rather than holding risky sovereign debt, were to hold a safe asset, not sensitive to sovereign risk, this diabolic loop would be mitigated at the very least. There is also another implication of the diabolic loop, which we saw at work in the euro area, which is essentially a flight, cross-border flight to safety. So essentially, this is like the international dimension of the diabolic loop, by which when a sovereign is destabilized in a country, the investors seek safety in other safer countries. So this is similar to the slide that Ricardo was putting up. It's just more geographically determined, so to speak. Essentially, the flight to safety, as we all know, was essentially during the crisis a flight to Germany. It was country that was and still is essentially supplying 80% of safe sovereign debt in the euro area, and so that's why it was a flight to Germany, because safe assets are asymmetrically supplied, or besides being relatively scarce, as Ricardo said, also they are asymmetrically supplied within the euro area. And here, again, SBIS can help, because first of all, they would reduce the likelihood of the diabolic loop, and therefore also the likelihood that this flight to safety might arise, but they would also, to the extent that still there would be sovereign crisis, the crisis would take the form no longer of a cross-border a capital flight, but actually a portfolio shift from high risk to low risk European assets. So what would we desire from a safe asset? What are the desirable features of a safe asset? First, in the context of the euro area in particular, first of all, we would want such an asset to be symmetrically, at least more symmetrically provided than currently it is in the euro area, but we also would like it to still be safe, at least as safe as the German Bund, and hopefully also more liquid than the German Bund, and more abundantly provided. And of course, the two things go together. You know, we all know that larger markets tend to be more liquid. Also, importantly, for political reasons, so political acceptability, we would want this asset not to feature a joint liability. So essentially, this rules out all existing proposals of euro bonds, which all involve joint liability among euro area sovereigns. We would like also this not to be too politically costly in case it kind of reveals to be a flop, in the sense that if investors don't like it, we want actually to be able to go back without too much cost. So we would like, for the same reason, it not to involve, have to involve treaty changes, European Union treaty changes, and also to be useful for monetary policy as well as for asset managers. Currently, there is not a liquid and risk-free benchmark yield curve in the euro area, and this the introduction of a safe asset in the euro area would, such as the one that I will discuss in a second, would provide that feature as well. So what are we proposing, essentially? It's not a new proposal. It was already advanced by a somewhat larger group of us, the Euronomics group in 2011. So we are now proposing it again, so to speak, putting it again on the table. The idea of ESBIS is quite simple. It is a kind of very plain vanilla form of securitization of sovereign debt, euro area sovereign debt, which exploits both the diversification that comes from pooling on the asset side and the protection that comes from tranching, so essentially seniority, on the liability side. Essentially, ESBIS are the senior tranche or senior bond, if you wish, which would be produced by such a securitization, which would enjoy the protection in case of default of any of the issuing sovereigns of given by the junior bond. Essentially, junior bond would stand first in line to take the losses coming from any sovereign default. Now, of course, the bigger is the buffer, the safer would ESBIS be, but also the less of them would be naturally available. So the question is, as you move the tranching point, essentially, how safe can you make them, and how much of them can you produce? And these are essentially issues that we first of all try to look at by way of simulations, as I said before. And we define a safe asset as one which has half of a percentage point, 0.5%, like expected loss rate over a five-year horizon. So it's equivalent roughly to a triple, the requirement of a triple A bond. Now we simulate these models over 10 million draws, and we have two reference scenarios, a benchmark scenario and an adverse scenario. Actually, we have several adverse scenarios where we increase both the default correlations between sovereigns, the probabilities of default, losses given default, and so on. We have a thick appendix in the paper where we experiment with all kind of more adverse scenarios that we could think of. The results are broadly still consistent with those of the benchmark scenario. So in the benchmark scenario, the idea is very simple. We have three macro states in which the economy can be. One is a very bad state. It's a crisis state which arises with 5% probability, in which the probabilities of default of all the sovereigns are quite high, especially those with worse credit ratings. For instance, Italy has in this state a probability of default of 65% and a loss given default of 80%. Then there is a bad but not so bad state, what we call mild recession, which arises with 25% probability, in which the probabilities of default are still elevated but lower than in the very bad state. And also the loss given default is 80% of the value as in the crisis state. And the good state, which arises with 70% probability, is one in which actually the probabilities of default are quite quite a bit lower, and losses given default are 50% the value lower than in the crisis state. And essentially, we the way we choose these probabilities of default are such as to make sure that our expected loss rates over a five-year horizon are broadly in line with those which are implied in, by CDS premia on these currently by these sovereigns. And what do we do with this simulation? Essentially, we use them to compare ESBIS, the thing that I showed you before, with alternative possibilities, one of which is essentially the status quo, so essentially the current debt which is issued by these sovereigns. Another one is what we call pure pooling, which is essentially just pure diversification, forming just a portfolio of GDP-weighted portfolio of these bonds without actually tranching them as well. Another one is a country-level tranching, that is neither pooling at the aggregate level, nor tranching at the aggregate level, but tranching at the individual country level, to get an idea of how far we can go with each of these. Now, this is the status quo. Essentially, this is the five-year expected loss rate on existing sovereign bonds according to our benchmark scenario. As you can see, only for five countries in the euro area, we have that the criterion for safety that we have chosen is met. These are Germany, the Netherlands, Luxembourg, Austria, and Finland, where the expected loss rate over a five-year horizon is less than 0.5%. All the others are quote unquote unsafe according to this criterion. But also that horizontal line that you can see in this picture, which is the level of the expected loss rate given by pure pooling, tells you that also simple diversification does not give you an expected loss rate below 0.5%. So it's also not safe. So just diversification is not enough according to our simulations. If instead we start using tranching, what do we get extra? Well, first of all, look at these lines here, these segments. What we do here is we look at different subordination levels, that is tranching levels, from 0 to 50%. And those segments that you see in this picture give you the expected loss rate that you get from ESBIS. So essentially, when you not only have pooling, but also tranching. Of course, with 0%, you get exactly 2.79, which is the same line that we saw in the previous pictures. But as you can see, the expected loss rate of ESBIS drop dramatically as you increase the subordination level, and in fact are already below the benchmark of 0.5% with 20% subordination level. And they're already below the German Bund expected loss rate, which is 0.13%, because you go to 0.09%, if you choose a 30% subordination level. If you go further, of course, you get practically to zero. In contrast, the bars that you see in this diagram here, I don't know if, these bars, they represent the expected loss rates that you can achieve with the senior tranche at national level. So if you do tranching at the national level for Germany, France, Spain, and Italy, first with 0%, then 10%, 20%, 30% subordination level. As you can see, the decline is much smaller. Essentially, you increase safety, but far less than you can do if you both have pooling and tranching. How much extra safe assets, and this goes in the direction of what Riccardo was saying before, how much do we increase the supply of safe assets by using ESBIS? Note, ESBIS, the supply of ESBIS is plotted in this diagram for different levels of the subordination level as the black bars. Now, you can see that there are no black bars corresponding to 0 and 10. This means essentially you don't get, until you get to 20% subordination level, you don't get any increase in the supply of safe assets with ESBIS. All of a sudden, you have that the senior tranche of the securitization, so ESBIS, becomes safe if you achieve 20% subordination level. At that point, you get the maximum bang for the buck in terms of the supply, increasing the supply of safe assets. You get almost 5 trillion euro of ESBIS, essentially, on the market. It's more than twice the supply of existing safe asset, that is AAA sovereign debt in the euro area. If you go to 30% subordination level, which is our benchmark, our preferred, so to speak, subordination level, of course you get a decline. You get less of a supply, but you get that this stuff is safer than German bonds. What are the gray bars? The gray bars indicate how much, what is the supply of safe debt that you would get from tranching at the national level. As you can see, it doesn't increase, it doesn't move very much. It actually decreases initially because, of course, you apply a more stringent criteria in terms of tranching level. It only increases a little bit towards the end because you get France essentially also into the game, so to speak, of producing safe assets by increasing the subordination level sufficiently. But anyway, you don't get as much of an increase in the supply of safe asset that, as you would with SBIS. This slide illustrates what is the five-year expected loss rate, so in a way the riskiness, of junior tranches. You can see that the expected loss rate also decreases, and these are the red segments in this picture, decreases dramatically as you increase the subordination level. And if you choose a 30% subordination level, it stands at 9.1%, which compares, it's kind of close to that of Portugal, which is almost 9%, or a basket of Italy, Portugal, Cyprus and Greece GDP weighted, which is 9.3%. Of course, it decreases even further if you choose a higher subordination level. Instead, if you again look at the gray bars, which look at the junior tranches of national securitizations, you effectively have no effect from raising the subordination level in terms of safety. Now, let me come to the last point of my talk, which is whether SBIS can actually not only redistribute risk, because essentially so far we have simply assumed that the amount of risk that that is currently present in the various sovereigns in Europe is redistributed across the two tranches. If instead of doing that, we ask the question, what would happen to these probabilities of default if actually due to changing behavior of the system through general equilibrium effect, the introduction of SBIS were to not just reallocate, but actually reduce risk. So if this could happen, there would be a second reason why SBIS would contribute to the supply of safe assets, not only in the sense of actually creating this tranche which is safer, but actually making even potentially the junior tranche safer. And the reason why we think this may be the case, and we try to make this point through a very simple model, is that, as I said before, it can reduce the chances of this diabolic loop operating. Essentially, the idea is that if you couple the introduction of SBIS with an inducement to banks to actually hold SBIS instead of domestic sovereign debt, you can reduce this diabolic loop parameter region. So to see this, consider how the diabolic loop may arise in a multi-country setting. We have a very simple model to capture this point. So we consider a very simple setting with two symmetric countries where investors are subject to independent sunspots. That is, they can suddenly panic about lose confidence about the solvency of their sovereign with probability P in both countries. Now, if the sunspot occurs, investors' pessimism causes the price of domestic bonds to drop, reducing the mark-to-market value of banks' equity insofar as they hold domestic sovereign debt, which makes, in turn, equity negative and pushes the government, or at least may push the government, to bail out the banks, which, in turn, has a negative effect on the government's solvency. And this can validate, essentially, the initial pessimism of investors. In this sense, the diabolic loop can be in equilibrium. Now, imagine that instead of holding all of their sovereign portfolio in the form of domestic sovereigns, banks were to hold alpha S, where S lower bar is the face value of domestic sovereign debt in the form of domestic bonds, and beta S of a pool security formed by 50-50 mix of domestic and foreign sovereign bonds. So essentially this is a kind of diversified, it's like our pool portfolio in the simulations, so that the total sovereign portfolio of banks will be gamma S, which is the sum of alpha S and beta S. Now, beta can then be seen as an indicator of the degree of diversification of banks in terms of sovereign risk. So if beta is equal to zero, you have complete home bias. If beta is equal to gamma, so alpha is equal to zero, then you have complete diversifications, and banks are holding 50-50 the domestic and sovereign and foreign sovereign bonds. Now, what we show in the model is that if you raise beta, this indicator of diversification, and you do not do tranching, so essentially here we are considering a pure pooling as a way for banks to diversify their portfolios, if you raise beta, this has two opposite effects. A virtuous effect, a positive effect, which is comes from diversification, but also a bad effect that comes from contagion. Because essentially, the diversification effect comes from the fact that domestic banks are less exposed to domestic sovereign risk, but the contagion effect comes from the fact that they are, by the same token, more exposed to foreign sovereign risk. So we can capture both of these effects in this picture. In this picture, you have on the vertical axis beta, which is this measure of diversification, which ranges potentially from zero to gamma. Gamma is perfect diversification, zero is complete home bias. But you have another quantity on the horizontal axis, and that quantity is the degree of capitalization of domestic banks. So how much equity they have. You can see that if E0, the initial equity of banks, is sufficiently high, anyway, irrespective of the degree of diversification of banks, you are outside of the diabolic loop region. You don't have, this diabolic loop equilibrium does not exist. If, however, this E0 is below that gamma pi tau phi L0 point, so it's to the left of this vertical blue segment, you have two possibilities. If banks are still highly capitalized, so they are in the interval between this point and this point, as you raise beta and you go up in that direction, you move from a region where a diabolic loop may arise only if there is a local sunspot to a diversification region where banks, where the economy is no longer exposed to a local sunspot. There is no longer a diabolic loop that can be triggered by a local sunspot, that is by a confidence crisis at the local level, at the country level, because banks are sufficiently well diversified and so not very sensitive to a local drop in the price of domestic sovereign debt. If actually you are below this point here, so if you are in this region and you increase beta, instead you have this kind of bad side, so to speak, this curse coming from diversification, which is contagion. Because at this point, if you increase diversification, since banks are not very well capitalized, you also import instability from the foreign sovereign. Essentially, you will have a more likely diabolic loop coming from contagion. Now, this is where actually ESBIS come in, because ESBIS are able, since they exploit not only diversification but also tranching, so they have offer better protection against a sovereign stress than simply pooling does. The introduction of ESBIS, as you can see, makes the region with no diabolic loop larger and compresses the contagion region as well as the diversification region, and does this the more so If you increase the tranching point, that is a subordination. If you go from the upper panel of the figure to the lower panel, you see that the contagion region and the diversification region shrink even further. And in the limit for sufficiently high tranching point, you have that the contagion region totally disappears, as well as the diversification region also disappears, and the non-diabolic region actually becomes highest. And what is the intuition for this? The intuition is that tranching shifts effectively default risk to junior bondholders, which are outside, by assumption in the model, outside the banking system. Okay, so that's the key thing, and therefore it kind of lowers the likelihood that this diabolic loop will arise. And notice there is a little miracle here that in the non-diabolic loop region, also the European junior bonds, so the junior tranche of the securitization becomes safe because there is no longer a diabolic loop. Okay, so to conclude, essentially the points that I try to make is that SBIS are in a way superior as a way to produce safe assets in the euro area, and probably this is a kind of more general principle, than pooling, because they also exploit not only diversification, they also exploit tranching, that is the benefit of seniority. And if we take as given probabilities of default and losses given default, they would more than double, or about double, the supply of safe assets in the euro area and still be at least as safe as the German bonds. At the same time, for that level of subordination of 30%, the European junior bonds would be about as risky as currently Portuguese sovereign bonds are. If banks were encouraged to hold these European senior bonds instead of the domestic sovereign debt that they currently massively hold due to the extreme home bias that currently is a feature of European euro area banks in particular, if they were encouraged to replace these domestic sovereign bonds with SBIS, their introduction, according to the model, would be able to break the bank sovereign diabolic loop, which relative to the results of our simulations would make SBIS even safer and AGBs less risky than our simulation suggests. So in a way, if there is some truth in our model, in a way our simulation results are quote unquote too pessimistic relative to the potential achievements of SBIS.
Thank you, Professor Pagano. Now, Professor Brunemeyer.
Thanks a lot for having me here, to be back here at the ECB. I guess everybody is now convinced that we need SBIS, and my task is to show you how to do it. And there are a lot of details to be figured out, and I want to go walk you through many of these details. So that's the implementation part of the paper. So the last part of the paper is a big chunk of implementation details. And the devil is in the details. And let's go through with the devil to the details. So what I will do is step back a little bit. I will give you a definition of safe asset, and I will contrast three definitions. Then I will talk about sovereign debt and banks, and there are some conflicting views within Europe. I might jump over this because the time is more limited than I thought initially. And then I will say, if you introduce some regulation on sovereign debt, how should SBIS be regulated? So there should be a certain principle that SBIS should, the only thing what is needed is that they're not disadvantaged. And we're also proposing an SBIS handbook where many of the details will be fixed or described or specified. And finally, I will say, how would you go in the transition phase to, from the current regime to the SBIS regime? So what's a safe asset? There is one which I say, safe is something which is risk-free at a particular horizon. So you have some guys who might be very averse and they want to hold these assets, some central banks or something. And that's one definition of safe asset. Goes a little bit what Cavalieri in his model is, but he enlarged it a little bit, so he's closer to the definition I will come later on. The second definition of safe asset is a la Holmström and Gordon, I would say. It's like safe is an asset which is informationally insensitive. So in a sense that you don't have to worry about that somebody has more information than you and you face a lemons problem. You know, you get 100 euros back, whatever state of the world realizes, and hence it's safe and I don't have to worry about asymmetric information. Others have more, so the lemons problem won't appear. That's an advantage of a safe asset. And then I've worked with Valentina Dato, so we push two attributes of safe assets. And the two attributes are the following. We say a safe asset is like a good friend. It is around when you need it. So when you need it at a random horizon, it is, has high liquidity, has high value, and you can actually make use of it. It is there, like a good friend. And then what the second aspect we call the safe asset tautology. Often an asset is safe because it's perceived to be safe. And a classic example is like in August 2011, when the US Treasury was about to default because of a conflict between Congress and the Treasury or the White House, actually the price of the US Treasury appreciated. So the fundamental got worse, but the price appreciated. So there is some multiple equilibrium story, and there's even a bubble component. So a safe asset in a model is often a bubbly asset. So it doesn't, the fundamental might move in the opposite direction than the price of the safe asset. And running with this, that's, I think, the definition of a safe asset. Of course, it's still open in the air. I think there's no, the literature has not converged to a final definition. Now, let me jump over the next thing, where it's in sovereign debt and banks, how we regulate the sovereign debt holdings by banks. There's some conflicting views. And this also relates to different views, which is, you know, much bigger in context I discussed in my book, which just came out. You have to read it to get it. Let me move on to the regulation of ASBIs. Essentially, the question is, if you were to introduce some risk weights on sovereign debt, how much risk weights would you put on ASBIs? And what we argue in this paper is that a fair way is this look-through principle. So the ASBIs, again, that's what Marco has shown. You have some portfolio of sovereign bonds. They are up to 60% of GDP. And based on some moving average of GDP weights, so you have some, and you take, they have some risk weights. So you take the aggregate risk weight, and then you concentrate the aggregate risk weight on the junior bond. And the senior bond, because it's safe, doesn't get any risk weight. So in a sense, the whole construction, if you buy the senior bond and the junior bond, which is like holding the whole portfolio, you have the same risk weight whether you buy a senior bond and a junior bond, or you buy the whole portfolio. Essentially, this is the so-called look-through principle, where essentially the risk weights are pushed towards the junior bond. It's a better arrangement having this ASBIs with this than having some, let's say, exposure limits, because this disadvantages small countries. If you have exposure limits, what happens is that all the banks, they will say, oh, we need a diversified portfolio, but we pick just the big sovereign bonds, and we will not buy smaller countries' sovereign bonds because their market liquidity is lower. So an ASBIs arrangement is a fairer distribution. It's a union-wide sovereign, a safe asset, rather than having not a union-wide safe asset. And again, as Marco has mentioned, that's important because the flight to safety capital flows are not cross-border anymore. They're actually, you know, from European level to a European level, they will flow from a European junior bond to a European senior bond, and both are European bonds. So money is not flowing out of the periphery anymore to the core, but it's actually flowing from one European entity to another European entity. So you might ask, so who is buying this junior bond? So this is, you know, all the risk is concentrated at the junior bond. Who will buy this junior bond? That's one of the objections we often get. Oh, somebody has to buy this, and who is taking on this risk? The first thing, and that's what Marco pointed out very nicely, Modigliani-Miller fails. Of course, we're repackaging existing risk. So essentially, if like in a simulation, we do just repackaging, you see you create a lot of safe assets. But because of this repackaging, individual people's behavior will change. In particular, banks' behavior will change. They will hold not the junior bond. And this essentially makes the whole risk smaller. So endogenous risk is actually going away. This diabolic slash doom loop is reduced. And that's one reason why the overall risk is going down, so more people can hold the junior bond, also at a lower yield. The second thing is why people might want to hold the junior bond, like our friend from pension funds and insurance companies, because it essentially gives them embedded leverage. So the asset, the junior bond, has embedded leverage in it. So essentially, it is as if I would buy a portfolio of sovereign debt, and I would lever it up by issuing 70% of debt. Now, what does it mean? I, as an individual investor, cannot lever up this debt, I cannot raise debt at the ESB's interest rate. But if I buy this junior bond, I get the ESB's interest rate when I lever up. That's a safe bond, safe interest rate. So this is a huge advantage. So this embedded leverage is way more attractive than a straight out leverage investors could do too. So it gives you an advantage compared to what we have at the moment. So for both of these reasons, there is, you know, there is, should be some demand for the junior bond. Now, what should be in the junior's handbook? So there are many aspects which should be specified in the ESB's handbook, you know, certain you know, standardization and all this. So one of the standardizations is, of course, because ESBs will be a much bigger market than the current fragmented national markets, there will be an arbitrage margin. So one thing is, because of this high market liquidity, where, who gets this arbitrage margin? We assume here in this specification that there will be a fund and accumulate and accrues, we accrue the benefits from this. And if there ever were a sovereign debt restructuring, you can use this additional fund building up. Now, there are also some market liquidity challenges we are facing. So one is this low debt level problem. So if you buy up a lot of this national debt and then issue a senior bond and a junior bond, there might be certain states, certain member states in the European Union or in the euro area whose debt to GDP ratio is not high enough. So the remaining, we have to essentially suck up all of that debt. So we don't have a price signal anymore from them. So that's one challenge we face. And the other challenge is there might be a small country problem. I said already it's a big advantage compared to the other proposals that the small country problem is much less of a problem in this proposal. But of course, it might be that we absorb a huge chunk of some small country's debt, and the remaining part becomes less liquid. The market liquidity is going down. So that these are two things which, you know, have to be debated as well. So how, what do we want to do in order to minimize that? So we, first of all, in the ESBIS handbook, we want to say that there is some standardization of ESBIS. It shouldn't be that anybody can just create ESBIS and, you know, do slightly different versions of ESBIS, and then we don't have any standardization and the market liquidity advantage would be lost. So we would like to have, if you do an ESBIS, if you issue an ESBIS, whether it's a public or private bank or institution, that the subordination and the tranching point is the same. You only can call your thing an ESBIS if you have 30% subordination or tranching point. The same thing is, so the portfolio shares of the sovereign thing should be the same. So we propose here GDP weighting, and the GDP weighting should be based on past GDP moving average in order to avoid any procyclicality. So if you just use the current GDP, it would be a problem. Let's suppose a country has a, goes through a crisis, the GDP weight would go down, and then there would be a smaller weight absorbing its debt. So this would be procyclical, and we have switched this off. That's why we had this moving average specification. The other thing is in the tranching, we don't want to have any maturity mismatch or very limited maturity mismatch in this tranching vehicle. Whoever does it, a private entity or a public entity, there's very little maturity mismatch in the sense that whenever you buy 10-year sovereign debt, you also issue a 10-year senior bond and a 10-year junior bond. And you do this for all different maturities in order to have a nice yield curve. What else is specified in the handbook? It specified how the national debt offices have to coordinate how they issue debt. So there should, it can't be that one country is only issuing 1-year debt and the other country is only issuing 10-year debt, then it's hard to build this no maturity mismatch vehicle. So there has to be some coordination across DMOs and in order to manage that. If they insist on this, you can still do some time tranching. That's some security choice you can still do, but it would be nicer if you don't have this maturity mismatch in the first place. The other thing is they have to coordinate somehow when to issue new debt, or they just have to say we issue frequently often, so it can't be that, you know, France is issuing in March 15th and Germany is issuing you know, in March 28th and there's a 2-week gap and we don't know how to build a portfolio. There's some additional warehousing risk popping up. The way to deal with that is to be announced securitization, where you do the securitization in advance and say, okay, France and Germany will issue something end of March, and if you want to buy a senior bond, that will also appear end of March, but we arrange everything in advance to be announced end of March. Everything will happen, but we do it already, you know, March 20th. And then at March 31st, everything will occur simultaneously. There's no warehousing risk, to reduce the warehousing risk. And it's also important that no country says, oh, by the way, now we issued a new bond which is senior to the ESBs. You know, before we serve the bonds which is in the ESB structure, we serve some other bonds. So this would undermine, of course, the whole thing. We also think it's very important, and that should be also specified in the ESBs handbook, that the ESBs issuer, in particular if it's a single one, or competing private ones, should have the right to buy in the secondary market. So it's important that the DMOs, you know, cannot corner and squeeze the ESBs issuers in a sense. So, but, you know, there is a possibility that if there's a shortage on particular bonds and the price goes wild, they can go in the secondary market as well. Now, I touched upon already who should issue these bonds, these ESBs and the junior bond. Should it be a public entity? Should it be a private entity or both? We don't specify in the paper which way to go. We just outline the advantages and the disadvantages. And that's a political debate we wanted to stay away from. And I can just tell you what are the advantages if a public issuer does it versus a private issuer, or perhaps, ideally, perhaps both can do it. So the danger with a public issuer like the ESM or the ECB on the euro system or generally, because we don't have someone, the ECB could do it for the part of the bonds they're holding which are part of the loss sharing, or for the other part, which there's no loss sharing, it's more complicated, or the European Investment Bank could do it. We think the ESM is probably, or ECB would be the more natural ones to do it. So the danger is, of course, if it's a public issue, there might be public political interference, you know, when there will be a debt restructuring, who has the power to decide what and how to restructure the debt. And you might not want this, or there might be some the market expects some implicit bailout guarantees and all that. The other thing is there might be some legal challenges because it's not clear whether this would, you know, require a treaty change or what regulatory or legal changes you need to go through. Not a treaty change, but perhaps a bigger agreement. On the other hand, it might have lower fees because, you know, the private sector might charge a higher fee. The advantage of the private sector is more arm's length relationship. And this is more important in sovereign debt restructuring arrangements. And the private sector might also retranche the junior bond, not in, you know, if one junior bond and then you tranche it again and you fine-tune it depending where the demand lies. But nevertheless, I think the issuers, whoever issues, sure has to be vetted and certified. So it can't be just anybody coming saying we create ESBs. And with the private issuer, of course, you always have the counterparty credit risk, the previous session's focus a lot to counterparty risk, so it's counterparty credit risk, but you can manage that with bankruptcy remoteness, so it's only the warehousing risk, and the warehousing risk you can manage with it to be announced securitization. Then there might be, so there's a counterparty legal risk if somebody is issuing ESBs under, you know, German law, and the other one is issuing ESBs on some other country's law, they might be not totally identical, so there might be some, we agree on a common law under what law these ESBs have to be issued, under what legal jurisdiction. So it could be that all the ESBs have to be issued under X country's law that has to be agreed upon. But the good thing is in this case, you don't have really, compared to other securitization, you don't have a moral hazard, you know, select what assets to put in because it's always the 19 countries' sovereign debt. You don't have to monitor. The only issue is when it comes to a potential default, you know, who has the voting rights to say we do some debt restructuring or not, okay? And that's why we had a whole subsection, how do you structure the governance during a restructuring, who has the voting rights? And that's something to debate and discuss about too. So what we think is that the ESBs issuer, the power should not be totally concentrated in, if there's a single ESBs issuer in this one ESBs issuer, because that would be too much a concentration of power. And it should be essentially a second look-through principle. So essentially, you take the votes which come from the sovereign bonds, and you distribute it to the European senior bond and the European junior bond according to their shares. And this way, you try to balance the conflicts of interest between a junior and a senior bondholder, and you have essentially the same look-through principle. We applied also for regulation more generally, but also apply to the power distribution in case of restructuring or if restructuring has to be decided. Okay, but that's something really for the worst cases which are important to deal with how the governance structure would look like. Now, finally, before I conclude, is the question, how should we you know, finally introduce it, the whole thing. So we have specified the long steady state, what are the details, how to do it. And as Marco mentioned, what's the nice thing about this proposal, about many other things, it has no downside risk. So let's suppose you propose it and it goes online and nobody picks up on it, then nothing happens. You just go back what you had before. So there's no downside risk, not that you get stuck and then it's much worse than before. You can always go back to the previous situation and nothing happened. Now, what we want to propose here is a three-stage introduction. The first stage would be some limited experimentation. So there's some entity, public or private or both, we'll see, that issues, buys on the secondary market some of the sovereign debt. And once the sovereign debt is bought, it issues the senior and the junior bond. Later, it moves on perhaps already to the primary market. But once one sees it works well and all this, in this stage you can always revert very easily. In the stage two, you introduce a big swap, and essentially the idea is everybody who has sovereign debt at the moment, they can participate on this big auction, and this auction they can say you can swap your sovereign debt for European senior bonds, a combination of European senior bonds and European junior bonds. If you have some bonds which are more risky, like let's say Greek bonds, then if you swap them, you get much more junior bonds and very few senior bonds. If you want to swap the German Bund to something, you get actually more senior bonds and fewer junior bonds, so such that everybody is, you know, reflects the current value of this thing. So people submit demand schedules. Everybody's submitting demand schedule. It's a multidimensional demand schedule. You see, depending on all the prices, the Bund price, the Italian bond price and so forth, how many of these things I want. You put everything in the market clearing mechanism and then you see what the equilibrium exchange rates are across these bonds, and then accordingly everybody can swap these arrangements. And it's very similar what you have in spectrum right auctions where you bundle things and you bundle whole things, various spectrum rights here, and here's different national sovereign bonds and then swapping it for SBIS juniors and senior bonds. Then the other thing we thought is that before you do this, that's all in the old regime. There are no risk weights on sovereign debt. Once you have done this, then you can phase in some risk weights. And as I said, the look-through principle, the risk weights for, there should be no risk weights on the senior bond. It should be all concentrated on the junior bond. The ECB can play a crucial role as well, on top of it, but being potentially one issuer. It can conduct monetary policy primarily with the senior bond. That's natural to have a benchmark yield curve, and also at the short end, it will conduct the monetary policy. Of course, it has to set certain haircut rules and all this, but of course, given that it's such a safe bond, and the simulation have shown it will be, you know, as safe as a German bond, that's actually, you know, very natural to have similar haircut rules. So let me conclude with this slide on the details and the implementation. I first started off what's a safe asset, and what we like, or what we termed this phenomenon, a good friend analogy, and the safe asset tautology. I think these are two marks of a safe asset. I jumped over this bank sovereign risk holding about the risk weights, where the conflicting views are in Europe, and again, it's one dimension where there are different perspectives in Euro, and there are some underlying reasons for that, deep reasons and different economic philosophies, and we talk in the book about these economic philosophies a lot, and this leads to these different attitudes, which I think we can overcome. I talked about who will buy the European junior bond and what's the advantage of this embedded leverage, and that's a big advantage. In terms of regulation for SBIS, we should just abide the look-through principle. That's essentially a fair treatment. There's no advantage and no disadvantage. In the margin, if we can give SBIS a little bit of an advantage, it would be kickstarting this, because we have to get this whole thing started at some point. And the SBIS handbook will then specify the whole standardization, what's the tranching point, what are the portfolio weights and all this, and how to harmonize the national debt issuances in terms of frequency, or how frequent we have to issue debt, more frequent, smaller issuances. And then we have to also have to decide, you know, is the SBIS provided by a monopolistic public issuer, or is it, it can be many private issuers, or both in this? And importantly, is the governance structure in terms of if there's a potential debt restructuring of one of the member states who has the voting rights then. And as I mentioned, once we have this, this is a long run steady state, and we can get there into three stages I just outlined before. I believe that does. Thanks.
Thank you. Well, I'll give the floor to Jeremy Zettelmeyer. I believe he will not be short of questions to address. And I will also ask the organizer maybe to give us more time, because we have I'm a lousy chairman, and we are you know, close to exceeding our time. But I think Jeremy has the right to the same time as the other speakers.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chair. So just to clarify my role here, so I'm going to be a discussant, but like, you know, Ricardo said, Ricardo and to a much greater extent myself are just garnish in this session, right? So the main dish is indeed the SBs, and we have been sort of strategically placed around it. So, you know, Ricardo provided the appetizer, then you got the main course, and now I'm going to give you some sort of dessert, or if you like, digestif, that makes it easier to and, you know, I don't need to be a digestif to the appetizer. And so I'm actually going to discuss Ricardo's presentation. Also, I thought it was very easy to digest in its own right, because he presented it very, very nicely. So I'm basically going to play the role of sort of a nice stress test, if you like. So a nice stress test is one that's not so easy as to completely lack credibility ex ante, but in the end doesn't really get you into trouble, right? So this is essentially what I'm going to do.
Stress test, you mean?
You said that. not me. Okay. So let me first give you a little bit of context. Like Marco said, the idea, the SB idea, has actually been around since late 2011. It was presented by a somewhat different and bigger set of co-authors in late 2011. To their credit, the set of co-authors has shrunk, because some of them have gone into public policy roles. And I believe that they still believe in SBs, even after having gone into public policy roles. So in that sense, that's probably the stress test you should take most seriously, more than anything that I could say now. Now, in spite of the fact that the idea received a lot of attention, it wasn't really taken very seriously by policymakers. Okay? And what we are now seeing is sort of a second, much more thorough attempt to argue the idea than the short paper that the authors produced in 2011, and also possibly in a more receptive environment, because things have changed in those 5 years. So, you know, 5 years on from 2011, there's still dissatisfaction with the Eurozone, but we are no longer in open crisis, and, you know, this may create a greater willingness to experiment at the margin. The lack of safe asset motivation, which was not the motivation that was originally pushed by the paper, it was there, but it wasn't pushed so hard, has picked up stream as a second, you know, leg that the proposal can stand on, and this is why we kind of flew in Ricardo to make that a strong case. Of course, you know, one of the problems in 2011 was that people really had the great financial crisis in their mind. So anything that sort of smacked of financial engineering, CDOs, SPVs, they actually called their idea an SPV in 2011. They probably quickly realized that was a mistake. And so this word SPV only appears right at the end of the paper in a particular context. So all these ideas are no longer that credited. You know, there's an official attempt at the European level to revive the asset-backed security market, and so, you know, they fit in there. And then finally, a particularly important point, back then, in 2011, they had a lot of competition from alternative proposals, right? There was the blue bond, red bond. There was a sort of European safe bills idea. There was the debt redemption pact of the German Council for Economic Advisors. There was, of course, you know, just plain Eurobonds. And so, you know, this essentially, all these rivals have run into walls. And the reason is that they all involve redistribution of some kind. And so this is the only proposal that, at least by design, in its own motivation, eschews redistribution, right? If it works as intended, it should be moral hazard free. And because distributional tensions in Europe have, if anything, become more entrenched within the Eurozone since 2011, it might help their idea, right? It might be a solution to a problem that doesn't impose a cost where people are very sensitive these days about that cost. And so the question is, will the idea now finally break through? And I'm going to try and answer that question. And, you know, like always, I'm not going to give you a very clear answer. So the answer is essentially, yeah, they have a good chance, it might, but they're not quite there yet. They might want to make a few changes, and that would make it even better. And the way I'm going to approach this is I'm going to go through the original set of objections and then ask to what extent the objections still stand, both given the passage of time and given the new version of the paper. So as I recall it, right, I've been sort of following this from the outside. There were essentially four objections. Maybe the fourth one is more my interpretation. The first and main objection by, you know, many people was, oh, you know, this may be a neat idea, but it's just way too complicated, too academic. There's just this ton of practical issues that arises and is left unaddressed. Okay, the second objection is, and this is sort of more the Germanic objection, is probably in one of the slides that you would have shown if you had had more time, is that SBs are just a way of introducing mutualization through the back door. So they're not as innocuous as they seem. Why? Because the great financial crisis has taught us that, you know, making claims about instruments being risk-free based on financial engineering are really fraught with risks. And if this goes wrong, you know, these SBs may in fact default or suffer losses, and then someone is going to be liable. Who is that going to be? Well, the part of Europe that doesn't cause that default, which is us, okay? The Germans. Now, in my case, I'm German, even though I do not work for the German government. Okay, so there's a lot of talk about the devil in this paper. You know, there's the devil in the details, there's the diabolic loop. But, you know, people may think that, in fact, the paper, the idea itself is pretty diabolical because it has this, you know, kind of hidden thing. You know, it's not openly mutualization, but it may have that implication. Then the third one was actually a point that was made a lot, and you mentioned that no one will really want to hold the junior tranche. In other words, you create something safe, but at the expense of creating a junk bond that cannot stand on its own feet, and if it cannot stand on its own feet, then of course the senior tranche cannot be sold either. And then finally, and this is more sort of maybe my spin, so the SB idea is very closely tied, and you know, you haven't really emphasized this very much, to the idea that you want to definitely give risk weights or impose some sort of regulation on bank exposures to national sovereign bonds, right? So it involves, it's a double bill, right? It involves, you know, a tougher regulatory regime for sovereign bonds than exists now. And that, of course, triggers a whole set of issues. Basically, there are many people who, out of interest or because they fear that this, you know, may cause a crisis, that this is going to lead to big shifts in asset holdings, are skeptical of that idea. Okay, so where do we stand with respect to these four objections? Just to give you a quick overview, I think the paper goes very, very far. I would say it's sort of 95% or 90% in my non-practitioner view in overcoming this first objection that this is a neat idea, but they haven't really thought it through, right? It really, really thinks it through, this version of the paper, I think. And I think what you also have conclusively defeated is this argument that there would be no interest in the junior tranche. I think that you have done a very good job of. So within this set, I think there's only one objection left, which is you know, fairly obvious, and the authors are actually aware of it, but it's not in the paper, which is related to how you're going to price the underlying national bonds once this thing takes off. I'm going to come back to this. On the issue of mutualization through the back door, I think the paper makes a lot of progress, but it doesn't fully succeed in overcoming that potential objection. And similar with respect to the last objection, which is whether this proposal, in a sense, makes too many enemies in a political economy sense to be successful. So I'm going to elaborate on these three points. So the first one, very quickly. So the worry is, I mean, once you get to the, like Markus explained, you can start introducing this at the margin. But at some point, you have to make the jump, right? And this is when you do this big debt swap. And at that point, depending exactly on how you set the upper bounds of what you're going to include in the SPV or in the portfolio, you could render a whole bunch of national debt markets illiquid, right, with one stroke. And this is obviously true if you decide to include all debt, but it's also true if you set some upper threshold as a percent of GDP. So they mentioned 60% of the GDP as a possible idea. Well, there are a whole bunch of countries in Europe that have debts less than 60% of GDP. And of course, you know, the EU fiscal framework actually tells all of us to get back to 60% of GDP. So in steady state, everyone is illiquid in your proposal. It doesn't have to be that way if you define the caps differently. So if you say 60% of national debts are included. Now, we briefly discussed it, and you said, well, but the Germans wouldn't like that. Well, but that has to do with the fear that there's something diabolical after all, right? I mean, if it's truly this is not going to be a source of moral hazard or transfers, then there's really no reason why what would have to set the cap at 60% of GDP rather than 60% of the debt stock. Now, having said that, if you do end up rendering some of these secondary markets illiquid, there is, in fact, a solution. And so my suggestion as a discussion would be that you take up this issue and discuss it in the second part of the paper, in the next version. And the solution is to basically rely on primary markets to do the price discovery. And so if you have a sufficiently competitive set of licensed private SP producers as purchasers, you can, in fact, do that. I mean, there is, having deep liquid secondary markets in government debt is not something that most countries in the world have, right? And yet, most countries in the world do issue sovereign debt, and the reason is because we know how to structure primary markets. Governor Ingves was head of the, I don't know what it was then called, MCM department at the fund, and a lot of what that department did was to go around to teach essentially central banks on how to do that. So you can actually overcome that objective. But it has a strong implication, which is that it kills the idea of using a centralized debt agency as the only or the main SP issuer. I mean, that, it seems, is inconsistent with any form of SPs that would generate this liquidity problem. So I think it does affect the discussion at the end. Okay, then quickly, on the issue of mutualization through the back door. So I think the paper has made progress here because the simulations of expected loss rates are much more thorough than in the early version. You do have an adverse scenario with some fairly massive contagion assumptions, and also the European Debt Agency is no longer at the center of the proposal, which is, you know, this potentially moral hazard-inducing institutions. Now, I still think that, you know, to the Germanic mind, this is not going to be quite enough. And the reason is the following. Basically, with the SPs, you do two things. First, you give us a recipe of how to construct a safe instrument via financial engineering. But secondly, you're also labeling this as a safe instrument, right? You're calling it European safe bonds. Now, like you point out in your work with Haddad, you can justify this labeling in terms of a multiple equilibria story, but you know, any sort of labeling can also create an implicit guarantee. And so if the instrument is really safe by construction, that's not a problem. But we know, of course, that safety via financial engineering relies on certain modeling assumptions. In particular, you assumed probabilities of default, cross-sectional correlations, loss-given defaults, and if you haven't gotten that quite right, then we are back to that world. So the question then is, how credible is the simulation exercise? So I looked at it. I think it's quite credible. You know, they look reasonable assumptions, strong assumptions, in the sense of being tough. But there is one objection that could really hurt you, which is that when you do the calibration, of course, you are using either credit ratings, but more important, CDS spreads that are based on, I think, end 2015 prices. And so there are many people with the Germanic mindsets arguing that these things are distorted and that they actually understate the true sovereign risk and the relationship between two sovereign risks in Europe. And so then if you have that mindset, you still are going to be worried whether your SPs could really withstand a multiple default. And so, you know, just out of interest, I sort of checked this in a very primitive way. Can I just bring this up? Which is mine. No, I do have one. Maybe this one. Oh, yeah. Brilliant. Okay. How do you get the... Okay. Do you have the little thing or? Okay, so this is a version of a table that's in the paper. So what you see here is Euro area countries, except for a group of smaller Eastern European countries plus Malta that I've grouped into one, just to make the table more manageable. And they're ordered in, if you like, in terms of credit rating, with the poorest rated countries, the riskiest countries, ordered on top. And then what you see in the second or third column is just the outstanding debt stock in percent of GDP and in billions of euros. Now, I've made an assumption on whether they would be included in the portfolio or not. And so, for simplicity, I've here assumed Greece would be out because it doesn't have tradable debt at this point. It's all official, almost all official, whereas everyone else would be in full. I have another table which shows what happens if it's only 60% of GDP, which I'll show in a second. So if you do that, then the portfolio weights in the SPV would be given by this column percent of included. So you would get roughly Italy, France, and Germany in the same proportion, right? Italy is the biggest national component in the basket, but only by a little bit. Now, you can make some loss given default assumptions, and so I have made some assumptions which are sort of essentially taken from the paper, but they're not the most drastic loss given default, because I've actually worked on sovereign debt crisis, and I think, you know, these are extremely high loss assumptions they made in the most toughest case in the paper. So I've taken sort of some sort of average of scenarios, but they're still very high loss given default assumptions. So in the case of an Italian default, we assume that they assume as their sort of central value that 69% would be actually lost. So then the question becomes, based on these assumptions, could the safe bond withstand, so to speak, a correlated default? And so in one scenario, I've assumed that all countries rated 9 or above would default at the same time. So this is essentially all the countries that had a problem after the great financial crisis, plus Slovenia, plus Italy. And, you know, my intuition was, well, you know, this instrument can be maybe withstand one or two big default cases, but not this complete set. Well, surprisingly, and it comes out of the beauty of multiplying these things with losses given defaults, it could, right? So if, you know, Cyprus, Portugal, Italy, Slovenia, Spain, and Ireland all default, and investors recover somewhat between 45 and 25%, and the rest is gone, then the share of defaulted debt in the total debt included would be less than 25%, right? So their 30% tranching would do it. So how far can you take this then? So this is the next one. I've added now a whole group of small Eastern European countries, which are the next in the pecking order. Doesn't do much because they have such a small weight, right? So then you add the next one. The next one happens to be Belgium. You know, Belgium is a little bit bigger. Even with Belgium defaulting, we are still below 30%. So in order to get above the 30%, we need France to also default, right? Then we are at above 40%. Now, if you're worried about that, you know, and maybe the Germanic mind might be worried about that, then you have two options, okay? You can either make the junior tranche thicker. You could raise it to 40 or 42%, if you like. Or you can do something that they sort of suggest in passing, but they don't actually explain it very well, and this is another suggestion that you should explain this more, which is rather than including everyone in full, you take everyone up to 60% of GDP. So that's a beautiful Germanic idea because you are effectively penalizing the high debt countries, right? They don't get into the basket, okay? And so if you do that, you would get slightly different portfolio weights. So I don't know, does this work here? So you need now see that basically what this does is it pushes the portfolio weight of Italy down from 22 or 23 to 16%. It doesn't do much to the French weight, and it pushes the German weight up to almost 30%. Okay, and of course then the consequences are that the share of defaulted debt, if we have a crisis in this nine above case, would be below 20%, and even in this catastrophic case where even France defaults, we would be at 35. Okay, so basically, you know, one recommendation might be actually to show some of these things as a complement to your simulations. Okay, I get to my final point. So the final objection is, even if one can deal with this mutualization argument, maybe the proposal would not survive because of its redistributional effects of forcing risk weights on banks. Maybe it just gets too many people upset with you. And so here, I mean, you know, make no mistake, I'm completely in favor of imposing these risk weights, right? I mean, that's my Germanic mind, but not everyone agrees. Now, here is where I find the paper a bit sketchy. So you have this whole story where you're trying to backload regulatory reform, you're arranging for the centralized swap mechanism, and so what is not clear to me is to what extent does the proposed auction mechanism have redistributional implications for European banks or not? Can you really design it in a way that doesn't have redistributional implications? How big would that be? I think to discuss that would be really crucial for the political economy of the proposal. If it doesn't have huge redistributional implications, this might be a good idea. So to conclude, you know, I'm one of these European economists who likes to think of European reform in terms of grand bargains, and I particularly like to do that before I worked for the German government. So, you know, the Austrians, the Dutch, ourselves and the Finns, we don't like mutualization, but we may have to give a bit on mutualization, and in return, you know, we get a new regulatory regime for banks that involves risk reduction throughout Europe, right? That's a sort of nice grand bargain. Now, I've also learned in my brief time in government that these grand bargains have the problem that you may end up with absolutely no support, because both sides hate you, okay? And so the question then is there a way of, you know, structuring your proposal that avoids this dilemma? And I think you're going in that direction by saying, oh, let's backload the regulatory change and introduce the SB at the margin. I think this is the right way to go. I think you may need to go even further in this direction in the sense that you need to come up with a structure of the SB that would be acceptable to the Germanic mind, even if they're in the end, they do not get the regulatory reform in return at the end. And that's a little harder, but it may not be completely insoluble. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, it seems that we have a discussion that was almost convinced, so it was not quite as critical as I imagine it would be. But we have a little time, but I think we have to give you the opportunity, Professor Brunemeyer or Professor Pagano, maybe to have a short reply.
Since he has the Germanic mind, I think
that he's a better seller.
he's better suited to reply.
Yeah, your accent.
Let's have
very
a big Germans here.
So let me say this. Of course, even if you can include all the debt, I think perceptions still matter. I think I would be, from a Germanic mind perspective, I would be very worried to say we include all sovereign debt, put it together. Of course, the liquidity problem would be the market liquidity and the price discovery in the national debt would be more complicated as well. But I really think it is, for the peripheral countries, a big benefit to have this arrangement because essentially it switches off the flight to safety across borders. Now it stabilizes the yields dramatically without little cost. It will perhaps cost something the German Bund, because the German Bund loses its monopoly position in as a safe asset. So there is something Germany gives up. And I think if then we do something which stabilizes the whole system and we get rid of this diabolic loop, I think that's something everybody should say that it's a public good. And I think that's why I'm still hoping for, you know, we achieve both. And we hope this to achieve this with a very smooth transition. That's why this big swap arrangement allows all the banks to reposition themselves at a fair price. And then subsequently, we phase in some risk weights, whatever they are. But we don't want any advantage, some big advantage for SBs. We just want a fair treatment through the look-through principle. You could do it without risk weights totally. But you have been in the German government. You probably know better than me. If you give something big on the one side, probably they want something on the other side too. And it's something which will cost something, but in the long run, it will make Europe safer. Let me leave it at this. Do you want to add something?
No, not really. We're short of time.
Okay, we have unfortunately exhausted the time for questions. We cannot have the opportunity to have questions from the floor and from some Harvard PhDs that I see around there. But we can continue our discussion over coffee so that to give time for the next session.
Thank you.